It's always a pleasure to meet young people, to meet people from different walks of life at various occasions. And today is no exception. I'm happy to be here in this town, a historic town of Kanpur, where I've been here many times before. But the first time to PSIT and to this beautiful campus. Thank you very much. Well, I am a Kathak. I was also in the civil services. The question is, do the twain meet? That was something which I was always asked. Why? Now let me tell you what Kathak has given me. And the two twain, did they meet? I'll leave that to you. But according to me, yes, they did meet. I'm reminded of a Sanskrit shlok by the seers of our ancient times. Sahitya sangeet kala vihina sakshat pashu puchh vishanahina. Without literature, music, performing arts in your life, you are like an animal without a tail, without horns. In other words, what does it say? It asks you, it exhorts you to develop as a complete human being in your development of your personality. And that was something that was ingrained into me since childhood. Now, when you are growing up, let me also say, all of us, we are all prone to a lot of fear. We do have ambitions and desires. The question is, you study, but the question is how you apply the applicability and whether the two again meet together, whether your fear overcomes what you want, and whether even in terms of your desires, what you have studied, what you are asked to do, whether you are going with a very closed mindset and you are unable to come out of it. The two, do they? How do we address it? I too face these situations in my life, like all of us do at every point of our lives. I do remember, let me share an incident. When I was barely 20 and I had already started making a name for myself as a young solo artist, I was performing in Bombay. Till then, my guru had been accompanying me, so there was somebody who was addressing you, who was helping you channelize, and you were just on the stage dancing. You didn't have to think it because there was this invisible person, my guru over there, steering you. But now I was on my own with an unknown tabla player. And it was conditioned into my mind that you have to do this, you have to do that. This is this. The question is, stagecraft is very different from what you're doing in your rehearsal hall. It is completely different. And that applies to all of us. What we study is different, but how you apply it in your life is different. And on this occasion, when I was performing, I went at the first portion, which was the slow portion, just extended, 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 extended. So much so that after some time, I felt the restiveness of the audience. The moment you started feeling the restiveness of the audience, that they were getting restive, you started getting nervous. So I started getting nervous. And at that young age, when you start getting nervous, you really get nervous. The fear factor. How do I address it? And there was a moment when the fear factor, the nervousness had overpowered me so much that it was a moment whether I was on stage or out of stage. I almost went to the wings, but something snapped within me. Said, I have to deal with this myself. How can I wait for somebody to keep steering me? And I took a pirouette, came pirouetting back onto center stage. And then I went into the madhale, and finally I had the audience in my grip. That was my first lesson of learning how to overcome your own fears, how to also understand the difference between what you're taught and later on how to utilize that same teaching according and apply it to actually what life demands you of you. That was a great learning experience and which has stood me in my life. The question when I said I had two parallel careers, you know what, when I was growing up, dance, coming from a certain background, dance was certainly a certain no, because it was not considered good for a girl from a good family to take to dance as a profession. Now I'm talking about the 50s and 60s. Now, so it was not the, and here I was, I wanted to be a dancer, but I loved studies, I wanted to study. So they said, these two do not go together. Come on, you are, okay, you're growing up, you're a child, finally, you'll grow out of it. The question is, I never grew out of it. I went on to do it. Did I have to follow the conditioned path, which was the normal path set by others before me, or did I have to make my own path? I chose the latter. I made my own path of having two parallel careers. And the question was, of course, again, it was a balancing on a razor's edge, either this way or that way, and you had to work extra hard on both sides to be there. Because dance, once you're on stage, nobody sees what you are. It is your dance which is there for you. And that only matters. And when you're in your civil service, it is what you do that matters. Now, the two together really helped me in honing about sensitivity. I remember an occasion when, as a civil servant, somebody had come, had been making rounds of the offices, finally landed up at my doorstep. I was joint secretary at that time, and said, I've been coming and making the rounds. I said, but why have you been making so many rounds? So the person was not on the seat. I called that young assistant, and I said, if today we are on this seat, but tomorrow we'll be on the other side. Once we are on the other side, would we like to be asked to come time and again and be returned without having been heard or our work being done? He said, no. Then I said, just imagine, if today you're here, tomorrow you'll be there, so kindly understand the condition of this old gentleman and be sensitive to his needs. It doesn't cost you anything except to lend a patient ear, hearing, and give a patient ear, and do either say yes or no, whichever is, but you have to. That sensitivity, where does this come from? It was the dance which gave me that. Because in dance, what you are understanding and you're talking about is sensitivity. It also tells you how to address diversity. Because there's so many diverse issues. We encounter diversity of opinions, diversity of people, diversity of views, diversity of even your behavioral pattern. How do we deal with it? You have to accept the diversity. But talking about behavioral pattern, one thing which, again, dance has always given all of us is the fact, how do we address ourselves? Everyone wants to be validated. Everyone, each one of us, there's not a single person who says, I do not want to be validated, what I have said or done, I do not want to be validated. Everyone does. And at the same time, each and every one of us wants to be respected. Now, if I want to be respected, I have to also respect others. Respect others' behavior, respect others' views, respect others as they are. But in that sense, I have to also look into my own self. What kind of a behavioral attitude am I suggesting? My body language should be such that it suggests positivity. It suggests a concern. It suggests sensitivity, not arrogance, not something that would put off the other, not something which is taunting. even in my language, one has to be careful. That has allowed, that is something that sensitivity and concern becomes part of our life, and that is what life has been teaching each one of us. Some of us see it and understand. Some of us fail to see it and we move forward. But it is for each one of us to learn these lessons of life. Obstacles are there. Obstacles will be there for each and everyone. It is how you overcome those obstacles with zeal, with determination, but importantly, with morality and ethics. Ethics is extremely important in my view. We all have to learn, and each one of us. I thought, you know, should I become a clone or a proxy of someone? I thought, why not be myself? And myself, again, when I said about the two parallel careers, I was myself, and I'm happy to be myself rather than becoming a proxy or a clone of XYZ. When I'm talking about diversity and it also helped me, dance has also helped me to understand that harmony, for example, how do we see one issue in so many different ways? Now let me quote one example. If I have to say, why was this young woman's hands burnt? Now so many would say, she doesn't know how to cook. She does not know how to do this. She does not know how to do that. She was lighting the fire and she was not careful enough, and so her hands were burnt. But I think literature helps us to see beyond it, helps us to go into uncharted terrains. Therefore, once again, literature also helps us to see how socially we have developed. For example, how many of us go to museums, and do we see actually, when if we have actually seen, we see those sculptures which are laden with jewelry, yet the ancient sculptures do not have a nathia. Today, if I have to show a woman, I'm showing a nathia, the nose pin. But our sculptures of ancient period do not show it, nor does the literature of ancient period. So it is only the medieval period. So how dance also helps you in understanding and seeing with our eyes, hearing with our ears. Because otherwise, we all have our faculties, but we do not utilize those faculties. Most of the time, we are seeing without seeing. We are hearing without hearing. We are speaking without even understanding what we are speaking. And in this context, I would like to do a small, if I have your permission, may I do a small demonstration? May I? Okay. So in that case, may I remove this? Okay. Now, I'm going to do a piece. If I have your permission, I'll dance over there. And this is a piece. Which again, today everyone, each one of us, sees, if you read the newspapers, there's violence all around. There is a gender issue, and men not respecting women, etc. Now, this is a piece which I've taken from the Mahabharata. I'll be doing a small piece for you, because here again, what I've been exhorting, saying that we have to learn to be sensitive, and we should have concern for everyone around us. I think that comes through. So, with your permission, I'll do a small little demonstration. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much indeed. Well, that was Draupadi Cheerharan, as you would have all known and understood. But are we able to? Is it happening today? Yes, unfortunately. All you youngsters, somewhere. We are all in the 21st century, but yet. And we are technically advanced, extremely advanced. But somewhere, we are still not very advanced at all, because we allow the basic emotions to take over. How does that help us? Are we really developed and advanced? And that's the reason which the first shloka, which I mentioned. That was the reason for us here, exhorting each one of us to look into ourselves, within ourselves, and exhort, and have that sensitivity within us. But it taken in 21st century terms, in environmental terms, you and I, each one of us in this auditorium, each person on the street is the modern day Dushasan. We are each one a Dushasan of today. Not in the gender terms, but in the environmental terms. Because you and I are removing the covering of Mother Earth. Mother Earth, who's Draupadi. You and I are the modern day Dushasan. And therefore, a poet has said, Dushasan bas karo. Dushasan bas karo, dharti ka cheer haran mat karo. Dushasan bas karo, dharti ka cheer haran mat karo. Phir dwapar ko dohrane ka dussahas mat karo. Dushasan bas karo, bas karo, bas karo. So let us inculcate that sensitivity within us. Let us grow into great human beings. Great human beings as human beings. Let us achieve all our, whatever we have desired in life, whichever vocation, let us excel in that. But let us not forget sight of the sensitivity and concern for our fellow human beings, for our fellow beings, not only human beings, but beings, and of the environment around. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you so much indeed. It is in our hands. We can change our attitude. We can change ourselves. So it is up to us. Let us change ourselves. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Thank you.